All right. Isn't God good?
Amen.
Glad to be in the house of the Lord today.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Boy, I look forward to coming to church. I used to regret going to church sometimes. But now I look forward to it. I love hanging out with my friends. I got more friends than any man I know of. You guys are my friends, and I'll tell you, more than friends, we're family. And we're going to grow closer together. We're going to be friends forever. Right. Think about it.
Yeah.
We're going to be friends forever. By the time we get to heaven, we're playing on that majestic golf course in heaven. Man, I'll really be able to drive then, right? I can't drive like the big boys, but I can drive, well, it's straight sometimes. How many golfers we got in the building? Raise your hands. Great. Oh, what? Awesome. We have a tournament coming up at the end of April. It's for Team Challenge. And so that's a drug rehab center in Pensacola. We've had them come here many times. Twice a year we have Team Challenge come to the church. They do dramas and they sing. And it's people who are addicted to drugs, they're addicted to alcohol, and they're getting their lives straightened out. So we have them come. There's 60 women and there's 100 men. So we'll have the men one day, and the next 6 months later, we'll have the women come. It's just really important to support that group. We support them financially, too, $100 a month. And so when you give money to missions, you mark missions, it goes partly to Team Challenge. But they're having a golf tournament, and I love playing in it. And, you know, I love to play in tournaments and give money away to people. And usually it's a best ball, scramble-type tournament. And I never, ever win one of those tournaments. One of these days, I'd like to come in first. I would love to win the tournament, but I go for fun. You know, golf's just fun. You got to have a good attitude when you golf, because you make some terrible shots. And it's fun just to laugh at each other. And some people have such unusual swings. It just makes you laugh. It's fun to laugh at each other. So you got to have a good attitude. Play golf. The title of my message today is It's No Accident. Oh, yes. Thank you, Trey. Come on up here. We have the first place winner of our Pinewood Derby. Yeah, play a little bit of that favorite here. Cole won first place. Big to be hitting that hard. We had a Pinewood Derby yesterday. We took the seats out here in the middle. We had the top of the ramp right here. And there's Curtis. And it is serious competition. One guy got involved. He doesn't even have children. He made a car. He loved it. So I'll tell you, we're making memories here at this church. Our kids are going to have the rest of their lives. And I think we can do that. Well, I know we can. We're already doing it. But I think it's important for the church. Adults, we need your help. We do something for the kids. You need to come and get involved and get excited and get pumped up. Right? You bring the party with you, right? And we're going to show these kids that we can have fun in church and do great things. And Pinewood Derby is one of those things kids will never forget. In fact, Holly and Jonathan, we did it for, I don't know, they're 17 to 21. We haven't done it in a few years, but we did it for like 8 or 9 years here in this church. And I am the worst at woodworking. Oh my Lord, I don't even have the right tools. But I've learned you can do a lot with a grinder, you know, one of those wheels. Just put that little wood up there and just start grinding it. It works out just fine. So we do a lot of great stuff. And Dennis, where's Dennis? Stand up, Dennis. Where's Tom? Is Tom here? Who works with the Royal Rangers? Stand up. Stand up. All right, thank you guys. I know it's a lot of work, isn't it?
Yes,
but fun. But fun, yes. Working for the Lord is hard work, but it's fun, amen. They took this whole center aisle out. That's just a lot of work right there, you know, doing that. So we appreciate you guys. Hey, When you're in God's kingdom, there's no accidents, right? It's divine providence, divine appointments. When something happens to you, God is working it out. God is bringing that thing. He's manipulating the system. So today I want to look at a divine appointment in the scripture. If you'll turn to John chapter 5, verse 1. We're going to look at one of these celestial accidents. No, it's not an accident. If you're a child of God, things happen to you that are in God's plan. Divine appointments. And when good things happen to you, I call them the Father's hugs and kisses. God will just bless your life, and it's like a hug, or it's like a kiss. When you get a check in the mail, or when someone does something good for you. The other day, a person who is my neighbor, he's not even a Christian. Listen to this. Not even a Christian. He tells me. But something told him to buy my boat from me. I've been trying to sell that boat for years. Bam, bought my boat. And then he goes, "Hey, Pastor, I'm renting a stump grinder. Can I come over and cut out those stumps for you?" I said, "I've been wanting those stumps gone for years." Bam, he came over and did our stumps. And I was like, God is using the unsaved people to bless me. That's like hugs and kisses. I'm like, thank you, Lord. It's no accident. It's no accident. That's God saying, keep up the good work. Keep up the good work. I'm blessing you. And God will do that to you too. He doesn't just do it to preachers. He'll do it to every one of his children. Because he wants to encourage you to keep on keeping on. Keep the faith, brother. So John 5:1 is a great story about a swimming pool, a healing, the pool called Bethesda. You know, Bethesda, Maryland, the big hospital. Okay, so this is where they get that from. Sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for one of the Jewish festivals. Now there is in Jerusalem, near the Sheep Gate, a pool, which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by 5 covered colonnades. Here, a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. One who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to get well?" "Sir," the invalid replied, "I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. While I am trying to get in, someone else gets down ahead of me." Then Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." At once the man was cured. He picked up his mat and walked. The day on which this took place was the Sabbath. And so the Jewish leaders said to the man who had been healed, "It is the Sabbath, and the law forbids you to carry your mat." That's just like religious people right there. The dude's been healed. They were worried about a mat. Oh, and then they said, "Who is this?" But he replied, "The man who made me well said to me, 'Pick up my mat.'" So they asked him, "Who is this fellow who told you to pick it up and walk?" And the man was healed. He had no idea who it was, for Jesus had slipped away into the crowd that was there. Later, Jesus found him at the temple and said to him, "Hey, see, you're well again. Stop sinning, or something worse may happen to you." Wow. Have you ever heard that preached? God does miracles in your life, and you need to change. Stop sinning, or something worse might happen to you. Jesus said that. The man went away and told the Jewish leaders that it was Jesus who made him well. Wow. So one thing we learn in life is that power corrupts. And absolute power corrupts. Absolutely. When men get power and control, whether it's in the government, whether it's a religion or a cult, what do? They start making rules. They start making rules. And usually the rules are for the women. I've noticed that all the bad stuff is inflicted upon the women. The men hardly have to do anything. But there is a book called the Mitzvah. It was a Jewish book, and it was full of their man-made rules. And there was 613 of these laws by the time Jesus got here. There were so many laws that people didn't know what to do. That's the way man-made religion is. And so there's 248 were positive commands, and 365 were classified as negative commands. They had these laws just for the Sabbath. They had 39 of them, they prohibitions to find what was permissible on the Sabbath, right down to the minutest detail. In fact, there's a negative mitzvah, number 321, for example, set the maximum walking range at 2,000 cubits on the Sabbath. I wonder where they got that from. Of course, this measurement didn't start until a person was 70 cubits and two-thirds cubits outside the city limits. What is going on? God probably looks down at man and our rules and he says, wow, this man probably jumped all over as he's healed, right? Wouldn't you jump all over if you're healed? Of course, it wasn't the invalid walking that caused the offense. It was the fact that he was carrying his mat on the Sabbath, breaking one of man's laws. Of course, there was nothing in the scripture to substantiate that regulation. And Jesus called him on it because Jesus was the one who wrote the law. He knew better.
Amen.
Amen. I'm glad Jesus fulfilled the Old Testament, though, aren't you? We're not bound by laws. We live by grace. Everybody say grace.
Grace.
We live by grace. We're not under the law. Jesus fulfilled the law. Okay? We live by grace. But he did give us one law. You know Jesus gave us one law? He said, a new commandment I give you. Okay? That you should love one another as I have loved you. I like that. I can handle that. He said, the great commandment, right? The great command, there's the great commission, right? Go into all the world, preach the gospel, okay? Baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, okay? That's the great commission. The great commandment is to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength. And what else? Love your neighbor as yourself. So I love it. So it's vertical, like a cross, like a cross. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And then love your neighbor as yourself. Those all around you. Love your neighbors. If you love your neighbor, you're not going to, you know the Ten Commandments, you're not going to break any of the Ten Commandments if you love your neighbor. You're not going to lie to somebody because you love them. You're not going to steal from someone because you love them. You're not going to commit adultery with someone's wife because you love them. So you're going to fulfill all the Old Testament commands, but you're going to be obedient out of love for Jesus because Jesus first loved you and me. Isn't that awesome? So that's our motivation for living, for doing good, for keeping them. Right? For doing right, not doing wrong is out of love, right? I love that. So there's no accident that Jesus met this man at the pool of Bethesda and healed him. There's no accidents in the kingdom of God. Amen?
Amen.
So look at your own life. Do you remember when you got born again? Do you feel, through observation, you look back at your life and the events surrounding your salvation experience, can you say, oh, that was a divine appointment, that was a miracle, God was moving me here, getting me in position that I might hear the word, that I had that friend who witnessed to me, or I came to church. Yesterday I was teaching a college class on evangelism, and one guy said, yeah, God did all these things. I saw God's hand working on me to get me from where Ohio down to Florida, where someone just happened to invite him to Easter service. It was on Easter 3 years ago. This guy got saved. Now he's in Bible classes. He already has a college degree. And now he's taking Bible classes just because he wants to. Isn't that awesome? The dude's spending money on Bible classes. He loves God's word. He wants to learn more. And he said, man, I look back at my life and I see how God moved. And then I was driving by the church and I wanted to go to church. I liked the building. I felt a tug in my spirit. That's the Holy Spirit. Okay. The guy wasn't even saved yet. Right? The Holy Spirit's moving upon his heart. You think God could do that? Absolutely. And he said, man, I sure would like to go to church there, but I just don't know anybody. And he said the fact that he didn't know anybody kept him away from church. But then God put someone in his path at work who went to that church. And they said, hey, would you like to go with me to church on Easter? He said, I'd love to. In fact, a few weeks before, he said, I woke up early and I was looking at the clock. He said, if I can leave now, I can make the early service. Then he slept in. He said, well, if I get up now, I can make the second service. And he didn't go. But when one person asked him to go to church, he went. He got saved that morning. His life was never the same. Is that great or what? I tell you, some people are passionate about automobile racing. Do you know any NASCAR fans? Are they passionate or what? Some people are passionate about offshore boat racing. And if I was a millionaire, I would probably be passionate about it too. It would be fun. I love going fast. But I'm passionate about winning souls. I mean, I'm not happy unless I win a soul. I love leading people to Jesus. So I'll tell you, one day when I die and go to heaven, I hope you all come to my funeral. I'll be watching. One day when I die and I go to heaven, I want to have people up there waiting on me that I've already sent ahead of me. And I want to be waiting at the pearly gate, waiting for people who are coming along behind me, people that I've led to the Lord. There's only one thing you can take to heaven, and that's souls. You're not going to take your fancy cars. You're not going to take your stuff. There's no U-Haul. I do funerals all the time. I've never seen a U-Haul behind the limousine, right? The hearse. There's no U-Hauls behind a hearse. This is you in that junky old suit. You're not looking your best. So, hey, the only thing we take with us is souls. And all it takes, oftentimes, is just, hey, would you like to go to church with me? I remember the story. I'm just freestyling now. Is that all right?
Yeah.
MJ told the story of how a guy in our church, Josh Brilliant, with the big arms. Josh Brilliant was in the Air Force in the first Gulf War, not the first Gulf War, but when we attacked Saddam Hussein, remember that? He was in the Air Force, he was out in the desert, he saw the first missiles fly over his head. And he was working on the base, he said, man, I want in on the action. He quit the Air Force, joined the Army Special Forces. And he got in on the action, maybe too much action. Well, he goes and he's on his GI Bill while his wife's here, active duty. And he says, I'm going back to college. He goes to college, meets MJ, Michael Jablonski. And he sees MJ, he's cool. MJ's cool. And so, tell me if this is accurate, homie. Josh goes, hey, you want to hang out? Did he say that? He did. Now, think about it. The guy's tatted up with tattoos. He's bad. Good looking, tall, big muscles. Hey, you want to hang out? Mike, MJ's like, yeah, dude. I'll hang out with you. This is witnessing 101. Everybody wants friends. Are you with me? I just taught a class yesterday for 4 hours. I didn't know I could teach so long on evangelism in the local church. Well, this is witnessing 101. Hey, you want to hang out? Yeah, let's go out. Hey, I go to this great church. You want to go? Yeah, I'll go. MJ comes to church, Catholic background. He's been abused by nuns. he went to school, in a Catholic school, you know what they do. I'm sorry, sister. Sister Mary Ellen. I'm sorry, Sister Mary Ellen. And he came to church, and I remember the day. He came to this church, and I walk in the back, and he's just like pumped up, like he just won a football game or something. And I guess he was giving your heart to the Lord, and he said this. He goes, man, I understood it. I understood it. Can I tell you a thing? The things of God are spiritually discerned. You can hear the gospel 100 times, it'll go over your head, you won't understand a word of it. But when the Spirit of God draws you and opens up your synapses in your brain to understand the message, that's a move of the Holy Spirit. Okay? That's a special event when your spiritual eyes are open. Until then, you're spiritually blind to the things of God. So if you're understanding what I'm preaching, you need to thank the Lord because He's opened up your spiritual eyes. This stuff I'm talking about, going over your head, right? You need to say, can someone pray for me? I don't know what you're talking about. Man, look at your life, man. Is God moving in your life? Did He work behind the scenes, cause these accidents to happen? I met so-and-so who brought me to church, or I met this, I got this job, and there was someone there. Some of you are in jobs like, why am I here? Are you in a job like that? It's not by accident. Maybe God has you there for a time because there's someone there you need witness to. So, hey, don't curse your job and have a bad attitude. Have a good attitude. Go there, right? And just get your little antennas going. God has me here for somebody. Who is it? Yeah. Pray about it. Amen. There's no accidents in the kingdom of God. On April 14th, 1865, what happened in America? In the 1860s?
Civil War.
Big deal, right? So Abraham Lincoln sat in the presidential box at Ford's Theater with his wife. Does this dress make me look big? You ever see that commercial?
Oh, that commercial.
Okay. Mary Todd Lincoln. For a Good Friday performance of Our American Cousin. The week before, Robert E. Lee just surrendered. Okay? Now I'm from the South, so I guess we lost. Robert E. Lee surrendered just 5 days earlier. And so, in Appomattox Courthouse, elation was in the air, but a battle-scarred nation would soon experience the same emotional whiplash the disciples experienced when Jesus entered Jerusalem and there was a party and a festival. At the end of the week, he's being crucified. America went through something like that. We win the war, and then Abraham Lincoln's assassinated 5 days later. Shocked and stunned was America. The renowned actor John Wilkes Booth knew the part by heart. He knew the play by heart. He knew that in Acts 3, scene 2, that's when 1,700 people, that's a big theater, 1,700 people were going to erupt in laughter. That was the funniest part of the play. So the president's box was supposed to be guarded by John Frederick Parker, but he left to go to a local tavern to have a beer with the president's footman and his coachman. They left him unguarded. When the audience chuckled on cue, the Southern sympathizer Booth shot the president at point blank range in the back of the head. The president's son, Robert Todd Lincoln, had declined the invitation to go, but as soon as he heard the news, he rushed to his father's side. Robert Lincoln would witness two other presidents' assassinations. Two other. He'd be present for two other assassinations. He was serving as Secretary of War under President James A. Garfield when Garfield was gunned down by Charles Guiteau at a train station in Washington, D.C. on July 2, 1891. The second incident happened at the Pan American Exposition in Buffalo, New York on September 6, 1901. Lincoln attended at the invitation of President William McKinley, who got shot in his presence. That's amazing. Now listen to this. That's no accident, just those three. Three assassinations he's connected to. But just months before, 10 months before his dad, Abraham Lincoln, was killed, he was campaigning with his dad. He was on a very bustling train platform, and there were so many people that as the train was going by, he got pushed off the tracks. And someone reached out and saved his life, grabbed him by the shirt collar, and pulled him back. And he told this to a newspaper. He said, when they pulled me back, right? He said, I recognized the guy. It was the famous actor, Edwin Booth, the older brother of John Wilkes Booth. Wow. John Wilkes Booth killed his dad, but John Wilkes Booth's brother saved Lincoln's son. Accident? I don't think so. Divine providence? Absolutely. You know what? Accidents don't happen in our lives either. Turn to Proverbs 20:24, and then we're going to go to Psalms 139. Turn to your book. God's Word tells us about accidents and divine providence. Look at this, Proverbs 20:24. A man's steps are directed by the Lord. Right? You're not going here willy-nilly there, like just in the wind, dust in the wind, right? Que sera, sera, whatever it will be. Half the audience just, I just lost you on that.
Paul, you're right.
Things just don't happen, right? By chance or no. God is moving in your life. God is moving in your life. Look at Psalms 139:13. 139:13. This, I want you to go there because this is really long and I want to camp here for a minute. And I want everybody to look at me. This passage, teenagers, young people, it's going to change your life. If you understand this passage, it's going to change your life. Maybe some of you older people need to hear this too. Let's go through this. Psalm 139:13. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. Who knit you together in your mother's womb? God. God had his hand on making you. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. In other words, God was watching me when I was being formed in my mother's womb. Man. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. Are you with me? Everybody wake up. Your eyes saw my unformed body. Man, this is important. Your eyes saw my unformed. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. Are you getting this? Are you understanding this? Before you lived one day of your life, God had all of your days written in his book. You might say, but I was an accident. No, you weren't. Your parents might have made a mistake. But you're no accident. God ordained you. God made you. He knit you together. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. There's no accidents in the kingdom of God. Wow. In light of this verse, can anyone say they are an accident? Can anyone say, I am unwanted? Can anyone say, I was a mistake? In light of this verse, absolutely not. Your parents might not have planned you to be born, but God planned you to be born. Amen. You might be the product of an illicit affair or a quick romance, but you might feel like you're a burden to your parents and you feel like they don't want you. But God brought you here by his grand design, and God definitely wants you. Amen. You're a keeper. God wants you. In light of this verse, can anyone say they are an accident? No. In light of this verse, can anyone really say they are unimportant or not valuable? It said that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. Man, I love that. Don't ever say, it would be better for me if I was never born. You ever said that to yourself? It would be better for me if I was never born. That is not true. Don't ever say, Father, man, if I would just kill myself, it would be better for my family. Don't ever say that. Because it's not true. It's a lie of the enemy. And I'm going to tell you, I'm going to prove it to you. Turn to Jeremiah 29:11. If you don't know where it is, just wait till we put it on the overhead. Sometimes finances get so tough. Have you ever been to a point in your life where finances are just really hard and you're thinking, man, why did my wife take out that insurance policy on me? No, I'm joking. Have you ever wondered that, dude, I'm worth more dead than alive? And the devil say, yeah, that's right, man, you should just end it all. Just hang yourself and go in a second. And your family would be happy. They could afford that car. They'd pay their bills. There wouldn't be any worry. Can I tell you, that's a lie from the pit of hell. Don't believe it. You're going through a time, but I'll tell you what. God's going to bring you through it. Right? There's night, but joy comes in the morning. This will soon pass. Okay, Jeremiah 29:11. I want you to hear this. Everybody listen to me. For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Everybody say, He has plans for me. Not just one plan. That plan has an S on it. Oh yeah, I got a plan. You're going to get saved and go to heaven. No, I got plans for you. More than just get saved and go to heaven. You and me, baby, we're going to change the world. God is saying to you, hey man, if you'll open up your ears and start listening, we're going to change the world. If you'll start being obedient to me, right? You and me, we're going to go far. Doesn't matter what your past was like, right? Your past is not going to dictate your future with God. I love that song on the radio. I love music. And this one song says, we are not the sum total of our past mistakes. Right? Well, I was an alcoholic. I'm always an alcoholic. Wrong. I don't remember reading that in the Bible. In fact, the Bible says, those who are in Christ Jesus are a new creature. The old has passed away. Behold.
Amen.
All things are new.
Yes.
You're not an alcoholic anymore. You're a saint. You're a child of God. You're the head and not the tail. You're a warrior in Jesus' name. Get your sword out and go. Win souls. Stop thinking of yourself as the way you were. You're not that person anymore. You have a new heart. You have God's Holy Spirit in you. The devil, though, will keep trying to trick you in your mind. No, you're just that big guy. You're just a loser. Just look, just like your dad said, you'll never amount to anything. Get thee behind me, Satan. Take every thought captive, make it obedient to the word of Christ. That's not what God says. God says He has plans for me. What kind of plans does He have for me? Plans to make me boring, plans to ruin my life, and plans to send me to a monastery where I can't speak for years. No, the plans God has for you is right here. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Man, yeah, but my parents, they never left me anything. I never got an inheritance, and they never even sent me to college. They didn't do anything for me. Well, that's okay, because now you have a father who's wealthy. Right? You got adopted by Daddy Warbucks, little orphan Annie. God is going to take care of you. He has plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you hope and a future. Say, I have a future in Jesus. I have hope in Jesus. Amen. God has plans. Here's the JSV version of that scripture, which is the John Skipper version. That's me. If you come back to Him and seek Him, He will restore hope to your dry soul and prosper you. You're not in this church this morning by accident. God has you here to hear this message of hope. So hang in there. Give God a chance and see if God won't do miracles on your behalf. There's no accidents in God's kingdom. When I was a youth pastor in Tallahassee, one night, we had this little boy show up. His name was Billy. He was a little skinny little kid, looked like he was 10, but he was 12. And I had these athletes in my youth group. They were like, big. So he was just a little boy. I thought, man, he's in the wrong group. He needs to be in the Royal Rangers. But he came to our youth group. And for some reason, and I gave an altar call that night, little Billy came forward and gave his heart to the Lord. 2 weeks later, Billy was dead.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, his stupid friends talked him into snuffing Freon in his own bedroom. He opened the air conditioner and was snuffing Freon. It froze his lungs and he keeled over. His parents found him dead in his own room. Little 12-year-old Billy. Wow. Isn't that amazing? But the grace of God, even in tragedy like that, the grace of God is that God had him in my youth group to hear the gospel. And he came forward and gave his heart to Jesus. The grace of God will cover your stupid mistakes, right? How many have ever done something stupid and even possibly life-threatening? Yeah. Don't worry, because God's got your back. And where there's stupidity and there's grace. Amen? There's grace. There's no accidents, man. God had him there for a purpose, to get saved, little Billy. The last time I checked the population clock, there were 7,121,929,889 people on the earth. If you were to put all the people together in a conga line at the equator, it'd wrap around the earth 57 times. That's how many people are on this planet. When you consider the vast number of people, you might want to get discouraged. Like, I'm a nobody. There's so many people here. But you should actually have the opposite idea or experience. You should say, man, I am blessed because I'm just one in a million, but Jesus loves me. And Jesus wants me to talk to him, and he'll actually listen to me. But I'm telling you what, it's even better than that. You're not one in a million. You're one in 7 billion. That's even more staggering. Yes, do you know what Jesus said about the little sparrow that falls to the ground? This is going to bring comfort and joy to your heart. Jesus said, are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. In other words, God even sees it when a sparrow falls down. And he says, and you're worth a lot more than a sparrow. You're worth a lot more than a sparrow. Wow. A sparrow was the cheapest ticket item in the food market in ancient Israel. Two sparrows could be purchased for one of the smallest and least valuable coins in Israel. Yet not one of them falls to the ground without God's care. Benjamin Franklin used the sparrow analogy. We were in the Constitutional Convention 1776, and they were getting nowhere. Southern guys were arguing about slavery, and then Northern guys were arguing about this, and they're arguing, and it was just not going to happen. They're trying to come up with the Declaration of Independence, and it just wasn't going to happen until the elder statesman Benjamin Franklin, he was like in his 80s, and he didn't talk much. He just sat there and listened. But finally, when he saw that this thing was going to not happen, he stood up, just like E.F. Hutton. When E.F. Hutton talks, people listen. Who in the world is E.F. Hutton? I don't know. Benjamin Franklin stands up, and he uses this analogy. He says, I have lived, sir, a long time. And the longer I live, the more convincing proofs I see of this truth, that God governs in the affairs of men. And if a sparrow cannot fall to the ground without his notice, is it possible that an empire can rise without his aid? We have been assured, sir, in the sacred writings, that except the Lord build this house, they that labor in vain that build it. I firmly believe this. Man, you might think today that your life is out of control, that God doesn't care about your life. But I'm here to tell you, he does care about your life. He is in control of what's going on. You've just got to put your faith in him. And faith is being sure of what you don't see. Well, I don't see God working in my life. Right? We don't see it. We don't see the hand of God maybe sometimes. But you know what? God's working. God's moving. Well, I don't see my husband getting saved. He won't even go to church with me. Well, you keep praying. You keep having faith. Right? God's working on them. God's working behind them. There's these divine appointments happening, right? That are going to come to a head eventually. Amen? Coincidence or divine providence? I'm going to close with this one last story. There was a guy named Paul Anderson whose friend had a son who needed a kidney transplant or he was going to die. So he said, Paul said, I'm a match. Like, this is a very rare thing, so I'm one of the only matches available. I'm going to give my kidney to Marquise. That was his name. I'm going to give my kidney to him. But a month before the operation was going to take place, the doctor said that he's too far gone. We can't do the operation. Well, his parents were Christian. Imagine what they thought. God, you gave up on us. But they decided, instead of to curse God, they decided to keep the faith. They said, you know what? We're going to trust God. And so this Paul Anderson started reading this book called The Circle Maker by Mark Batterson. The Circle Maker, if you don't know, is about a guy named Honey, the Circle Maker, who prayed for rain because there was a drought and people were dying, literally dying, in Israel. So all the Israelites came out of Jerusalem and they went to Honey, and he came out and he was a big tall man. I think of, when I heard that story, I think of Gandalf from Lord of the Rings, because he had a 6-foot staff, probably a big hat. Because when you live in the desert, you've got to have a hat. And Honey said, okay, I'll pray for rain. Takes that big staff and he draws a circle all the way around him. And he sits down. I'm not leaving this circle until God brings rain. He began to pray, and he began to pray, and he began to pray. And then rain started to rain. It started raining pretty good. The people were rejoicing. Man, Honey started praying, and God sent rain. It was great. And Honey said, Lord, I didn't pray for this little rain. I want buckets of rain. It's great when you say, God, I don't want little rain. I want big rain. You know what? God loves that attitude, that audacious, I trust God for great things attitude. He wasn't bossing God around. Hey, when you're friends with God, it's not bossing. And God said, hey, I'll give you more rain. He started pouring sheets and flooding of rain. Well, this guy, Paul, is just in the hospital getting out because they can't have the surgery. And he gets his book, and he stays all night long, and he reads his book. And he says, man, that's just like the Israelites marching around Jericho 7 times. Oh, yeah. He said, you know what? I'm going to walk around this hospital and I'm going to pray until God does a miracle for Marquise. So he starts marching around the hospital. You know how many times he goes around? 350 times. It was over 300 miles. This happened in 2013. I tell you, when God sees determination like that, God moves. This guy starts marching around the hospital 350 times, and then his miracle came. They did the surgery. God answered and did a miracle, and this boy was able to get his kidney. Is that amazing? So the boy, Marquise, survived. Isn't that great? But that's awesome. But that's not the end of the story. God was orchestrating it all. More than a decade earlier, okay, Marquise's father, his name is Jim. The pastor asked Jim if he'd give his testimony at a men's retreat. People don't want to hear my testimony. Can I tell you something? As an aside of the story, when your pastor asks you to give your testimony, just say yes. I'm going to tell you why in a second. When the leadership of the church is being led of the Spirit to ask you to do something, just say yes. Here's why. He said, okay, I'll give my testimony. It's not something great. But he gave his testimony. And you know, there was a guy there named Paul. And Paul was as lost as you could imagine. Paul's life was in tatters. But something touched him about that testimony. And Paul Anderson gave his heart to the Lord. And 10 years later, he gave his kidney to Jim's son. Saved his life. All because he was obedient to the word of God and gave his little testimony. God honored that. So you just don't know what miracles in store for you if you will step out in faith and do something for Jesus. Hey, well, I'm just an usher. I'm just a greeter. Well, Lord, you step out in faith and you greet like you never greeted before. You put your heart and soul into greeting. You put your heart and soul into ushering. You do whatever it takes. I'll tell you what, you just don't know who's coming through that door. Nothing happens by accident. God's going to bring someone who's on the verge of suicide, right? It's happened before. I was preaching a sermon like 9 years ago, and I was the worship leader. So for about 3 years, I led worship, and then I preached, playing my guitar. Not that electric guitar. I played the acoustic. And so I'm playing my guitar, I'm singing. This guy walks into the church. He was tall and handsome. And then after the service, he took off. And I was like, I don't like it when people just take off. I like, maybe my sermon was bad. Maybe he didn't like my guitar playing. Maybe, you know how you think. And so then he came back in. And he goes, man, and he's like this tall guy. His name was Lee. Man, that sermon just touched me. And then he leaves. And he came back the next week. And he had given his heart to the Lord. And I didn't know this, but Lee owned two companies. He was very well off. And he said, you know, I can buy anything in this world I want. I can just write a check. He said, but you know what? I wake up every morning at about 10 or 11, and I reach for a glass of vodka, and I start drinking just to get out of bed. He said, I didn't even want to live. He said, but something happened, and that skinny little preacher was preaching at me. God changed my life. Now I don't even need the alcohol, and God did a miracle in his life. Is that amazing? You just don't know, usher. You just don't know, greeter, Sunday school teacher, what God is going to use you to do. Because God is bringing in people in this church who need Jesus. Isn't that exciting? I'll tell you, next week, I've got some homework for you. You know what it means when the pastor closes his iPad? Absolutely nothing. No. I've got homework for you next week. Next week, I want you to bring a friend with you to church. Okay, I want you to think, who is my most evil friend? I want you to think, who is in my circle of friends that will never get saved? Do you know someone like that? Do you know someone? I hope you do. I want you to think about them. And I want you to invite them to come to church next week. Because there's something supernatural that happens in this church when the word of God goes forth. The Bible says, my word will not return void. When people get under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, they're hearing the word of God. God might open up their spiritual ears. They'll hear the gospel for the first time. And they'll weep. And they'll give their hearts to the Lord. And we have just changed history together. All because you were bold enough to say, hey, would you like to go to church? Hey, you want to hang out? Are you man enough? Are you woman enough to invite someone to church? I'm telling you, I want this church filled to overflowing next week. People are going to get saved. We're going to do an altar call. They're going to come forward, and we're going to rejoice. And you're going to be so pumped up, so excited. You're going to make a friend who's going to be your friend for all eternity. I mean, can you think of somebody, a better friend than the one who led you to the Lord? You know, 90% of the people that get saved because of a friend. It's all about relationships. It's all about relationships. Invite them. They did a survey of people who don't go to church. They said, if you went to church, when would it be? They said, oh, Sunday. Right? Majority of people said, I would go on Sunday. Well, of all Sundays of the year, what do you think, which Sunday has the most unchurched people in it? Easter. Man. So this week we have homework. I want you to bow your heads and let's pray right now. And I just want you to think of somebody that you know of that you're pretty sure are not Christians. I want you to picture their face. And I want you to pray for them. Say, Lord, I'm going to step out of faith and I'm going to invite them to church. Lord, I want them to actually come. And Lord, I want to get them saved. Let me ask you, as your head is bowed and your eyes are closed, how many here would say, Pastor, I hear what you're saying. There's no accidents in the kingdom of God. And I'll tell you, I don't believe I'm here by accident. But I'll tell you, I've been away from the Lord. I am not a Christian. And if I died today, I'm not even sure I'd go to heaven. If there's any doubt in your mind, today's the day you need to ask Jesus into your heart and make a commitment to Him, to serve Him with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength. How many would raise your hand and say, Pastor, you're talking to me. I want you to pray for me. Just lift your hand up. So you're talking to me. Yes, I see a hand. Anybody else? Anybody else? How many say, Pastor, you know, yes, I see the hand, you put it down. How many say to me, you know, Pastor, I used to serve the Lord, I used to be really on fire for the Lord, But then I joined the military, or I got away from the Lord. Life got in the way. Life got busy, and I've just kind of fallen away from the Lord. But something's telling me I need to get back close with the Lord. How many raise your hand and say, Pastor, pray for me. That's me. I'd like to rededicate my heart to the Lord this morning. Anybody here? Yes, I see a hand. Anybody else? Yes, 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 I see a hand. Anybody else? God's working on you. Yes, I see a hand. Praise the Lord. How many say, Pastor, I've been such a half-hearted Christian. I've been so lukewarm. I can barely string one Sunday a month to go to church because so many things are more important. How many say, Pastor, me, I'm ready to go after God with all my heart. Raise your hand and say, Pastor, I need to kick it up. Yes, I see a hand. Yes, I see a hand. I need to kick it up. Hallelujah. How many say to me, Pastor, you know, I'm a Christian, but I'm going through some stuff right now. There's things going on in my life. Maybe you're just tired of your present situation. Maybe it's just getting to you. Maybe your life is depressing you. Or maybe you got some crisis in your life right now. Maybe there was a tragedy in your family. Or maybe you have financial issues and it just keeps you up at night. You just got such issues that it's just driving you crazy and you're losing sleep over it. How many raise your hand and say, Pastor, pray for me? Yes, I see a hand, I see a hand. Keep them up. Yes, 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 yes. Hands going up all over the place. Yes, I see that hand. You know, oftentimes God puts more on us than we can handle for the very exact purpose that we'll fall to our knees and say, Lord, I can't handle this. I'm crying out to you today. I need your help. Oftentimes God will put more on us than we can handle. It's not because he hates you. It's because he loves you. And this stuff drives us to him. And just like the prodigal son, the father, he ran when he saw the boy, the prodigal son, but from a far off distance, the father ran off the porch, ran to him and hugged him. That's the heart of our Father, that even if you're far away, but you say, I'm ready to come back to you, Father, God runs to you. Jesus runs to you. He loves you. Yeah, you might have let him down. You might have backslid, but you know what? That doesn't matter. Jesus forgives. Jesus forgives. And he warmly welcomes you back. I love it. I love it. That's the heartbeat of Jesus. Let's just pray together. Say this out loud with me. Say, Dear Lord Jesus, please forgive me of my sins. Wash me as white as snow. Put your Holy Spirit in me. Guide me into all truth, to teach me right from wrong, to convict me when I'm going the wrong way, to encourage me when I need encouragement. Jesus, I thank you so much for dying on the cross for my sins. Today, I commit my life to you, wholly and completely. I give it to you. Lord, I pray for people who are under stress right now, under incredible stress. They have crisis. Maybe they're under financial bondage right now. I just pray in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you start doing some miracles in their lives. Lord, as they commit their life to you. Lord, as they draw near to you and you draw near to them, Father, I pray that you just do miracles in their situations. Lord, that they'll begin to see signs of light at the end of the tunnel. Lord, that there'd be a hug and a kiss waiting for them as they get home from church today. Lord, I just pray, Holy Spirit, that you give them a sign that you're on their side. Lord, I pray for my sins, or my friends, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.